fantasy, caught in a landslide,
no
escape from reality. Open your eyes, look up to the skies and see. I'm just a robot, I need no mercy, because I'm easy come, easy go, little high, little low. Anyway, the wind blows doesn't really matter to me. Mama, I just killed a man. Put a gun against his head, pulled my trigger, now he's dead. Mama, life had just begun, but now I've gone and thrown it all away.
Hello, everybody. I'm Wendy Friesen, and in a few minutes, we're going to start the class 1B of the Addiction Freedom Training from the Addiction Project. So if you're watching a recording of this, welcome. You can certainly still ask questions in the chat room, and those questions will go directly to me, and I'll still be able to answer you. So if you're watching the recording, go ahead and still ask questions. But this one is live. How confusing is that? Just don't even know if you're live or recording. Either way, it will be awesome. So, we will be starting in just about 5 minutes.
Goodbye, everybody. I've got to go. Gotta leave you all behind.
Thank you.
And I'm going to start in about 1 minute.
Anyone can see nothing really matters. Nothing really matters.
In the street, gonna be a big man someday. You got mud on your face, you big disgrace. Getting your chant all over the place, singing,
we will rock you.
Buddy, you're a young man, hard man, shouting in the street, gonna take all the world from me.
I'm going to wait just a couple more minutes for people to show up. So if you are getting ready, just a couple more minutes before we get started.
We will rock you.
Buddy, you're an old man, poor man, pleading with your eyes, gonna make you zombie someday. You got
mother. Hi, Becky and Bob and Edward and Ellen, Paul, Robin. Woo! Just working on some energy. Can you all hear me? Can you hear me okay? All right, we're almost ready to start. Just want to make sure everybody gets a chance to pop on in. Let's see. Okay. Sound is fine. Edward says, we will rock you. That's right. I have a feeling we're going to rock you. Today's our day. Rock things! Yay! Okay, we're ready to get it going. So, gotta say bye-bye to Queen. Bye-bye, Queen. There we go. All right, I'll play some more music on our break. Well, first of all, I wanted to tell you that this is the official start of the second series of 5 classes for addiction freedom training for counselors, coaches, and therapists, and it is based in hypnosis and hypnotherapy and NLP. I'm Wendy Friesen, and I am very excited to welcome many new people to our class. Kathy Galen is in New York. Joanne Williams is in the UK in Merseyside. Ellen Adamo-Yurka is in New Jersey. Mary Dempsey joined us. She is in Ireland. Very exciting. Julie Ivy in Australia. Victoria Brees. And Darren Lee in France. Yes. And Susie in Bedfordshire in the UK. Robert Bees from East Sussex in the UK. And I think Gary Collier is new in Seal Beach, and Dr. Carol Suter is new in California, Lake Forest, California. And let's see, on my list, yeah, I think Vanessa in Australia, she was already here. So there we have lots of new people. The last minute people have been piling in. It's pretty exciting. We're creating something that is going to change the way the world treats addiction. So the first thing we're going to do is learn how to open people's minds and make them see things from a whole new perspective and help people to really understand why this is such a powerful and totally needed and necessary method for helping with addiction. Feel free to chat in the chat room and to ask questions. I'm going to go over a few things first. And one of the first things, of course, is that we have students who have already taken the training, and many of them are going to be back in this training, because the more times that you hear it, the more ways that you learn it, and also the variety of information you'll get in each class is going to enhance your ability to do presentations, to speak to clients, to talk to doctors, to go into treatment centers and do presentations. Every time you hear it, it's going to be maybe a little different, clear something up, or it's going to embed the information so that you remember it. One of my main objectives is to get you to the point where this is just natural to you. If you're asked a question, let's say you're doing a presentation to an addiction treatment center because they're considering having you come in and teach your classes in there. You, no matter what question they ask you, you want to have the answer to be automatic, to be right there and be clear and concise. So the more you hear me say it, the more clear and concise it will get for you. The stories that I tell you from my real life experiences with addiction with my oldest son and rehab stories, you use those stories not as your own, but as stories that are true and real from the addiction field. And I'll tell you a little bit more about how I feel about that as we get started. First thing you need is, many of you already have this manual, which is your Addiction Freedom Training Manual. And it also works as a fan. How handy. And you need to have this. You may have downloaded it. If not, it's on the web page that's the online class notes web page that you all have links to. The printed version is on its way to all of you. I'm shipping them out just as soon as I get your orders. The other thing you're going to get is the Alcohol Freedom Program. This is 6 CDs, and every CD has several processes on it, and some of them you're going to be using in the work that you're going to be doing. This is my best-selling program of all time. I've been selling this for about 10 years. And, boy, I'll tell you, people, when they hear the ads for this, because I used to do a lot of radio advertising, when they hear the ads, they immediately want to buy it. They've got their credit card ready. They had no questions, and they would order it, like, just next day air. They're desperate for help. That's a clue about where your clients are going to be. Now, next thing is this workbook, which you're going to get some of to begin with, and then you can order more when you're ready. Each of your clients will get this workbook. You're going to use this to take them step by step through every segment and help them understand what they need in order to succeed. This is going to help change their minds about the things they learned in 12-step and AA. It's about your beliefs, your desires, how you think, what changes your values. There's all this journaling in it, and you are going to have a very easy job of leading them through it and finding out what they want, what they need, and applying that to your next lesson. So it just is a very beautiful manual, and you're going to get those, and this is going to be the thing that helps you lead an entire group or a private client or anyone at all that's looking to quit drugs or quit drinking. And then, oh, you have marketing materials that you're going to get in your package or you already have. These are brochures that you can give to a client or to a treatment center or to a doctor's office who's going to refer patients to you. You can take them to schools, universities, anything. So this one is all about addiction freedom, a little overview of the program. This one gives a lot of very specific beliefs we have and processes that we use and how we achieve such freedom from addiction. And this third page is testimonials. So these are testimonials from people who have used this program either in person or on CDs at home. And I have thousands of these. And then thousands of testimonials. And then there is a beautiful certificate that will have your name on it. And what this certificate says is, says the Addiction Project, Transforming Addiction Treatment, And then it says, has a place for your name, of course, and it says you're a relapse prevention expert. And that your name has achieved excellence in the course of relapse prevention and addiction freedom. So let's go through the concepts real quick of what this course is, and then we will get started. So addiction freedom is a term that people who are in AA or 12-step are going to feel a little bit bristled by because they don't believe you can achieve freedom from addiction. However, people do it all the time on their own or with help or just by simply making a decision at the very core of who they are that they're going to change and that it's done. And achieving freedom from addiction means that you're no longer doing one day at a time. Relapse is not part of recovery. You are not diseased. You're no longer shaking hands with someone saying, hi, I'm George, I'm an alcoholic. You're free from it. So freedom is ultimately the goal and a very quick goal that we want to achieve. The work that you do is a relapse prevention specialist or expert. So you're not helping people quit drugs or quit drinking. They do that all the time on their own. People are experts at quitting. They quit heroin all the time. They go through horrendous withdrawals. And it's so bad that they swear they will never do it again, never do heroin again, or opiates or OxyContin or whatever their opiate is. And yet they do, in part because the withdrawals are so horrible. But the point is that they quit all the time. So you're not treating them for addiction, because technically addiction is a disease. So you're not treating a disease. What you are doing is keeping people from relapsing. That's why you're a relapse prevention expert. So if you can get those words to roll off your tongue, the program that I have is Addiction Freedom, and it gives people freedom for life from their drug and alcohol addiction. I am a relapse prevention expert, and I can help anyone to know that they're never going to have to struggle with fears of relapse again. So with some of the groups we've worked on are elevator speeches. Now the elevator speech is 30 seconds. It's called that because it's supposedly the time you would have if you stepped into an elevator with someone awesome and you're ready to give them your spiel, but you have a very short time before the door opens and they leave. So your elevator speech is very, very important. People you meet anywhere, you've got to be confident. You've got to show that you absolutely believe what you're saying, and you've got to nail it and have a solid ending. You can't just go mamby-pamby all over the place and kind of trail off to like, yeah, well, so that's what I do, and I sort of have been doing it, and it's kind of working for some people. No, not at all. You want to have very, very solid elevator speech, right? Okay, so in the room right now, Susie, who's new, Jared, who's awesome, Robin, I love you, girl, Paul, Minerva, Gary, Ellen, Edward, Bob, and Becky. Oh, welcome to all of you and all of you who are also watching in the replay. This is awesome. Remember, you can talk to each other and you can chat in here, ask each other questions or ask me questions. Susie says, it looks like you started 16 minutes ago. I actually turned my camera on and my broadcast on at about 8 minutes till. So you really haven't missed much, okay? Susie says, the timing's out here. You've only just come on. That's interesting. Okay, well, that will make a little delay in asking questions, but it'll still work. Okay, let's get started. So you are a relapse prevention expert, as I said, and I want to tell you my story real quick. My oldest son, as many of you know, who is 30 now, has been in and out of rehab for drug and alcohol addiction. It's mostly been opiates that are his substance, which opiates are OxyContin or heroin, Vicodin. Very, very hard to quit. 6 or 7 times in rehab, 6 or 7 times in county jails for drug offenses or probation violations because of drugs. So one of the things that happened was I went to a lot of meetings at rehab centers that he was in. I paid over $150,000 for him to go to 5 of the rehabs. They're very, very expensive. You may not know this, and we will be learning this in this course, but a lot of treatment centers for 1 month are $25,000 to $35,000. Some are $40,000 or $50,000. There's one we're going to talk about that's $80,000 for 1 month. They have no guarantee. Most of them, their success rate is 5 to 7%. So make sure if you have your notes printed out that you're taking notes on things that you want to remember. So with a success rate of 5 to 7%, that means there's a lot of people out there who are really struggling, because what I learned is that they're teaching you and hypnotizing you to do exactly the opposite of what you need to do to make something change. Those of you who are in this training who are hypnotherapists, you know that if someone came in to quit biting their nails, you certainly wouldn't want to tell them that in 20 years from now they're still going to be struggling every day with biting their nails. Even though it's going to be really hard, you can do it. You would not suggest to them that they're going to relapse, that that's part of quitting biting your nails. You wouldn't suggest to them that it's a disease or that you're actually addicted to that. What you would do is you create a very positive, very confident basis for them to create the values, the behaviors, the beliefs, and change what's happening not only emotionally, but physically in their brain. You would rewire the neural pathways in their brain to get those neural pathways to go to entirely different feelings, emotions, responses, and beliefs about themselves. Now, those who have been in my training before know that there's three things that we want to achieve, and that is that you are strong, healthy, and in control. Now, when I went to the rehabs where my son was at, one of them, these are some of the stories I want you to remember, and I want you to be able to tell these stories, okay? So if you need to take notes, great, or you can watch this again on the replay and take notes. But these stories are ones you can tell, and you can say them, like I can say, I was in this rehab, and George, who is a famous speaker that goes around to all these treatment centers and AA meetings, you know, and you can simply say that in one of the rehabs, it was a very expensive one, a man named George got up in front of the meeting. Make sense? It doesn't mean you were there, but it's true. And so you can tell the stories. Okay, so here we go. So I was in the meeting and sitting there, and a man named George, who did travel to all these 12-step meetings and treatment centers, he gets up in front of the group and says, "Hi, I'm George. I'm an alcoholic. I've been sober for 20 years. But I have to tell you all that even today, I'm just hoping to make it till midnight." Says it's hard, and you're going to have to really work hard at this. Because even after 20 years, he says every day, it's a struggle. So what did he just do? So those of you who are in the chat, what did he do when he told that entire group that even 20 years from now, they're still an alcoholic who's introducing themselves as an alcoholic, they're still hoping to make it till midnight, they're still going to trouble. They're still going to struggle. What did he do to them? So go ahead and type it in the chat room. Okay, so the next story is kind of interesting. This was a treatment center. It was a private one where people signed up for an entire year. And they would come in and go to a meeting at 6 o'clock every night for 2 hours. And it was basically a 12-step meeting, except that the people paid a yearly fee, which was $12,000, to be part of that. So in that meeting, the director is talking to one of the guys and says, "So, Jim, you're a high relapser, right?" And Jim goes, yeah, I am. And the director says, "So when do you usually relapse at? 30 days or 60 days, what's the point when you always relapse?" And he says, well, usually it's 30 days. You know, sometimes I make it to 60, but it's usually 30. So he just told this addict that he's a high relapser. What did he do to him right in that moment? Of course, this isn't the first time he told him that. Repetition is a huge way to change someone's behavior and to influence them. He has used repetition in every meeting to talk to Jim about being a high relapser. He labeled him. He created an identity of being a high relapser, which creates behaviors and values. But ultimately, what did he do to him? Go ahead and type that in the chat room. So then, in another meeting, same rehab center, the director says, "Oh, well, you know, it's almost the holidays. We got Thanksgiving and Christmas coming right up. So we're going to watch the videos again, the ones that are going to talk about how hard it's going to be to get through the holidays and to try to help you, you know, stay strong. And everybody groaned because they've seen those videos so many times before. They know them inside and out. And he says it's going to be really hard when you're out there and other people are drinking, and it's going to be really, really tough. And that's when people relapse a lot. Well, what did he just do? He certainly opened the door for them to expect to relapse, even give them permission to fail, because it is supposed to be hard. And ultimately, what is happening is that this is hypnosis. When you listen to someone in authority and they tell you how something is, especially if they are talking from the future that you're supposed to be in, they're hypnotizing you, future pacing you, putting you in that future, implanting it in your subconscious mind. Robin says he future paced them to struggle. Minerva says future paced them to remain struggling forever. Jared says he anchored hopelessness, relapse, and powerlessness. Becky says gave them an expectation of having to struggle forever. Forever is a long time. Susie says he landed the suggestion that it will always be a struggle. Absolutely. Yep. You guys understand. Bob says direct suggestion that they will still have the problem for at least another 20 years. He reinforced the identity as a relapser, says Susie. Becky says future paced him to having relapsed. Edward says reinforced his time triggers for relapse at 30 days. So these are stories I want you to be able to tell. Now here's another rehab center that my son was at. On the day he was going to be released, several others were being released as well, and the director looked at all of them and said, now you know that in 60 days, only 1 in 12 of you will still be clean and sober. Now imagine this. You've just spent your mom's money of $30,000 being in this rehab for a month. You're about to get out. What kind of thought do you want to leave with? What would you want to feel? Okay, so now, this director says, only 1 in 12 of you will still be clean and sober in 60 days. What does that do in your mind if you could imagine yourself right now thinking, wow, I just did all this work, went to all those effing meetings, and now I find out that only 1 in 12 of us is going to be clean and sober. Well, why should I wait 60 days when it's all good? This is what they're telling people in these rehab centers. And they have a 5-7% success rate. So, big rehab center in Costa Mesa or Newport Beach, Sober Living by the Sea. I sat down with the director, Ryan, and he said, Wendy, I don't know what to do. We only have under 10% success rate. He says, I don't even know. It might be only 7 or 8%. And, you know, there's another one. There's $30-some thousand. He says, we don't know what to do to improve our success rate. So they're at a loss. All these treatment centers that believe that 12-step is the only way, they believe that the disease model is the only way. They don't know what to do. And they need someone who has solid evidence, who has science to back it up, who has a methodology that is rock solid. And they need someone to come in there and do a fantastic job. Because if they don't, and if they don't hire you to come in there and do some work, they're not going to have many clients left, because this movement that I'm creating and that all of you are part of and you're creating with me, we're going to make it very vocal and very obvious that the world is getting it wrong with 12-step and AA. They have got to use a different methodology. So Bob says perhaps they want them to come back for another month of profit, and you are right about that. So they aren't going to come back to the same treatment center because that one didn't work. They're going to go to another one, but all these treatment centers know that, you know, we still have more clients. They keep coming back and coming back. And people find the money to pay that much for treatment for a loved one, because it is better to put yourself in debt for another 20 or 30 or 40,000 than to have your child or your mother, your father, your husband, wife, whoever, possibly die, or to go through the torture that you're going through of living with an addict. Jared was commenting on something previously. It says creates expectation of failure and permission to use. Yeah. So what if a treatment center, this is another thing that you can write down and you can say that's going to get people going like, wow, that's the craziest thing ever. What if a treatment center was like someone who's selling you a car? So let's say you're going to go buy a car from someone. It's a business that has ethics and is held to some rules and regulations and things. So there's this business that's going to sell you a car, and the car is $30,000. And you're told that in 1 month, there is only a 5% chance that this car will still start or work or run. And I have no guarantees, no money back, there's no warranty, nothing. If that car doesn't work in 30 days, which chances are it won't, 95% chance it's not going to work, you can't get your money back. You need to buy a new car. That would be fraud. The treatment centers know they're doing this. And there's one comment from someone, I don't remember who it was, but it was a counselor at an addiction center who, it's in the book. It might be in the Sober Truth book, where she interviewed a lot of treatment centers and got the truth out of a lot of them. But I guess the counselor was reprimanded for having too high of a success rate and said, we've got to keep our success rate down at below 10%, something like that. And I don't know if that's true or not, but that's what I had read somewhere. So anyway, that's where we're at with the problem. The type of treatments are, there's AA and 12-step. Most rehab centers, no matter how expensive they are, use the 12-step model. So what does the 12-step model tell you you should believe? So go ahead and type in some of the beliefs of the 12-step model. And most of you know who they are. If you're new, go ahead and take a guess. You may know from your own experience. And put down what you think they want you to believe about your addiction. And you know, while you're doing that, isn't it interesting if you do talk to any addicts how much they own the disease, you know? I have a disease. I'm an addictive personality. My mom was an alcoholic, so I am genetically screwed. You know, if I start drinking, I don't know, I just might be out of control. People feel like they don't have any choice about drug and alcohol addiction, and it's really quite amazing. When I was in my early 20s, it was the 80s, and there was a lot of cocaine around. And I did cocaine for a couple of years. And when I quit, I knew absolutely that was it. I wasn't going to do it anymore. Changed everything about my environment. Did the things that put in my head that I am absolutely going to be free from this. And if anyone ever talks about it around me or has it or anything, I'm just going to walk away. And I just imagined and pictured myself just leaving no matter what. Because there was no way I was going to get caught up in that again. But this is where we're missing the boat with the 12-step model. So think about things you might be typing in. I know the chat has a bit of a delay, but it's that you're powerless. You are diseased. You have to every day just try to make it till midnight. It is going to be a struggle. What else? Keep typing in what the beliefs are about 12-step and AA beliefs. So if you're a hypnotherapist, which many of you are, a client that comes to you for any reason at all, you would never tell them that they are powerless, that they're going to keep struggling, that they're going to have to struggle because they've got this personality. That's just their personality. They can't change it. We know that people make miraculous changes all the time. And we know that we have the tools and the key to get their mind to open to that and to change what's happening in the subconscious mind. Minerva says, AA tells you that you're always diseased and you're always on the verge of relapse. So that phrase maybe changed a little bit, Minerva. It's that relapse is part of recovery. So yes, you're on the verge of relapse as far as the fear that's there, but their terminology is relapse is part of recovery. What a belief to have. Edward says, always an addict and you're diseased. What if it doesn't work? What if you go to 12-step in AA and you relapse? It doesn't work. What do they say about you? What do they tell you? And I know you've probably heard this. It works if you work it. The program works if you work the program. It works if you work it. You must not be working it if you fail. It works if you work it. What else do they tell you if you relapse? This one just scares me a lot. So Susie says they teach you that you'll always be an addict and you'll always be fighting the force. Yep. That's for sure. So you must surrender to a higher being. Yes, surrender. Oh, and if you relapse, you just have not surrendered. And most people who really are sick of AA and 12-step, they say, if I hear the words surrender one more time, I'm going to lose my shit. Okay. Now, thank you, Jared. Nailed it. High five to Jared. Jared says they haven't bottomed out, but they say hit bottom. So Edward says they have to hit bottom and you re- So I've done this. I've been in centers where I'm going to a new rehab center to sign up my son. And I say, well, Sean just keeps on drinking and he's still using and he went right back to it. And they say, well, he hasn't hit bottom. I said, well, actually, I think he has. He's living on the street. He has nothing to say for his life. He has destroyed his health. He's stolen from people. He's been in jail. I think he's hit bottom. And you know what they say next? He hasn't hit his bottom. These are the words that come out of their mouth. And there is an absolute fact. There's science behind the fact that you do not want people to get worse. You do not want them to go deeper into depression and fear and guilt and anger and hopelessness. Hitting bottom is not a strategy for creating a healthy person. As soon as someone wants help, they get help. You give them help. Not reached rock bottom yet, says Bob. Yeah, that's right. Okay, so the new thinking. The new thought is in the science of what it takes to change the neural pathways in your brain. If you're a hypnotherapist, when you're doing your work with a client, you're helping them by growing new neural pathways that connect to new emotions, new beliefs about who you are, new personality traits. We're also using mirror neurons. You may not know what those are. We'll talk about them. Mirror neurons make you internalize a new behavior and to adapt it physically, mentally, emotionally, and strive to achieve it. So if you go to 12-step and AA meetings, you are modeling that behavior in there. You're hearing the sad stories. Your brain is growing mirror neurons to more failure, pain, and fear, and doubt. Your mirror neurons are absorbing the behavior of all these people who are on the edge and afraid, right? Okay, these are the things I want you to be able to describe to doctors, treatment centers, to rehabs, to your clients privately. I want you to be able to get the point across. But of course, the materials are going to help do that for you. And this book is going to get so many of those points across, plus it's going to help you to know exactly what to discuss with them. So, for instance, if we were looking at self-sabotage, and we're explaining, as the book also explains, that sometimes there's bad things that you do, but they're for a positive reason. There's a positive intention behind the bad behaviors. When we find that positive intention about your drug use, there's a lot of things that are going to dissolve, that are just not going to be a problem anymore. Let's see. So this section's about repetition and why it's so important. And says blazing the path, and it's like in your brain creating that new pathway, which we'll talk about a lot more as well. But anyway, that just helps you get that client where you need the client to be. Okay? So the new thinking is that we do have the ability to change the way our brain works, reacts, the way it's triggered. And I will tell you that clients that I've had, whether they're in person or just people who have bought and used the Alcohol Freedom Program all over the world, they do have freedom from their addiction. We change the triggers in their brain. So part of this new thinking is actually changing the triggers into a different outcome, which is what you do with clients anyway, but we actually do it for addiction. When I started doing some work for addiction, drug and alcohol addiction, I thought, oh, who am I to be doing that? I have no training in being an addiction counselor, and I don't know anything about treating people for drug and alcohol addiction, but I figured I'd try, as most of you probably have. And I'm curious, how many of you have seen people for addiction, and what kind of addiction? Just type in what, if you've seen clients for drug addiction, alcohol, porn addiction, of course smoking, most likely, but what other things have you seen them for? So, one of your first homework assignments that you're going to need to do, hopefully before tomorrow, we know it's a lot, is reading up to page 11. Now, the printed training manual, the page numbers are different than the online one. But I want you to read up to page 11. And it ends with this right here. So this would be the last page where it says strong, healthy, in control, powerful, worthy. And it would be page 1, except in the printed version it says page 4. So anyway, it'll take you through some of the things we're going to be talking about. Bob has seen someone for cocaine, Gary for smoking, Susie for smoking. Changing the triggers can be really miraculous. So if you wire the brain to have the thing, the glass of alcohol, with the smell and the ice and the all of the things that it was triggering, but instead we're going to get the brain to rewire those neural pathways that when it sees alcohol, when it thinks about alcohol, when you drive by your favorite bar, when you see someone else drinking, you see an ad on TV or in a magazine for alcohol, immediately your brain is going to go to this feeling, and you've created this massive new experience in their brain, which is consisting of strong and healthy and in control, that includes all the beliefs, the values, and the emotions, and the desire to have a big, tall, cool glass of water or a cup of warm tea or some bubbly club soda or Pellegrino, whatever they like. So you create a trigger that the subconscious automatically goes to when they see alcohol or smell it or notice anything about it. It's like one of my clients that used the CD, she says, when I'm in the grocery store and I'm going by the wine aisle in the grocery store, she says, I feel so good, I just kind of dance with my cart on the way through because I know it has no power. It doesn't affect me at all. I feel freer and happier every time I see it. So another guy that had quit drinking, had only been a couple months, he was at a conference and he was sitting at the bar, and his friend, who didn't know that he quit drinking, bought him a glass of his favorite whiskey, waved it under his nose. And you know what that's called. When we smell something, there's a word for it. It's olfactory. When you smell something, it's a phenomenal trigger to get you to want to do something, especially in addiction. When he smelled that, it triggered his brain to feel strong, healthy, and in control, and trigger the massive feelings of freedom, knowing that he loves his healthy life. And he told me, he says, when I smelled that, I knew. There's no way I would think about having a drink. I just felt better, stronger, and happier instantly. Isn't that cool? This is what you're going to do, and this is why we're going to change the way the world treats addiction. That's why, because it's amazing. All right. Oh, so the other thing I didn't mention is after 1 hour, we're going to take a break for 10 minutes, just so you know, so you don't have to run out and miss anything right now. All right, so we're going to talk about the homework pages up to page 11. We're going to talk about those tomorrow, so I want you to read them so you have a basic understanding of them. All right, so now we're going to talk about the 6 elements of change. These are on the exam. Pay attention. So there are 6 things that you need to create permanent change. Some of you definitely know what they are. And this is in part what this manual is based on. Bob says, you have 120,000 miles of neural pathways in your brain. Come on! Wow. 120,000 miles of neural pathways. And 100 billion neurons. And we used to believe that the brain was done growing by age 25, right? And in the last 15 years or so, they have discovered that the brain keeps growing all of your life. Now, as hypnotherapists, we know that the work we do builds new neural pathways. That is not, we're not guessing at that. We know that for a fact, that we're building and reconnecting new neural pathways. So the work of Joe Dispenza, he's traveling all over the world just talking about these neural pathways. If you fire it, you wire it, and he has the science that backs it up. Bruce Lipton wrote Biology of Belief, and he's going around lecturing on how our beliefs about ourselves change the biology of what happens not only in our brain but in our cells. So this would be nice for you to remember, to be able to explain to someone. Bruce's Biology of Belief and Joe Dispenza's work about the cells, they're not the only ones that do this, but they're very popular for explaining it. Thoughts that you think send a chemical response from your brain into your body. Of course, they do grow new neural pathways. When those chemicals go into your body, they go to your cells, and your cells receive those as a chemical state, and it affects your cell at the gene level. So this is epigenetics. Okay? So if someone asks you, oh, well, so do you know about epigenetics? Yes, you do. Epigenetics is how the things that we have in our environment, our upbringing, the choices we make, the things we choose to think about and believe about ourselves or about our life, that they affect our genes, and they can turn a gene off or on. So you may be predisposed to a certain disease, but you may never have it, you may never have a symptom of it, and you may not even have the possibility of having that disease. Because the work on Biology of Belief is that your thoughts, your experiences, your outlook, your attitude, everything at a cellular level, it makes the gene decide to turn off or on. So it changes that genetic expression, which is another phrase you want to be able to use. It changes the genetic expression. It does not change the gene. It changes the genetic expression. If this is the case, do you really have a disease? Are you really predisposed to a disease? Is there a choice? Are there factors that could change that? And think about alcoholism or drug addiction being a disease. Now, in the definition of disease, you know, certainly it is a dis-ease, but it's not a disease that you own, that you're stuck with, and that you have to have all of your life. Okay, so we create expectation, and when we create expectation, then a person realizes, maybe I don't have to always go around with this disease. I can expect to have my life, my body, and my health back. So the six elements of change, go ahead and type in what you think they are. What are the six things that we need to change our personality or our body, mind, spirit permanently? So what is the first one? Find my notes. Where did I put my little notes? There they are. The six elements of change. Belief is the first one. But go ahead and type them in. So what you believe definitely affects how your brain and how your body react and respond. If you believe that in 20 years you're still going to be struggling, you will still be struggling. You're going to send that message to your body every time you are triggered to want to drink or to use the drugs. Your body is going to respond with the belief that, yes, you're supposed to struggle. Relapse is part of recovery. It's going to be hard. Oh, it's hard. Yeah, boy, it's true. Boy, what that guy said is just so true. Okay, Gary says, desire. Yeah, can we change anything if we don't have the desire to change? We need to have the desire. We have to have a reason. People don't stop doing drugs or stop drinking because it's kind of a good idea. They do it because they have a real serious desire to change because some bad stuff's happening in their life. It's not working out so well. Identity. Thank you, Gary. So identity. Who are you? Are you, hi, I'm Sally, I'm an alcoholic. Or, hi, I'm Catherine, I'm an addict. I've been clean for 20 years. Huh, imagine that, and I'm still an addict. So your identity, who are you? Are you, I'm Wendy, and I am healthy and happy. And my body, I love my body, whatever, well, parts of it. But, you know, the things that you hold as your identity. When people own their disease, I have IBS. My IBS, I don't have IBS, but I'm just saying if a client says, yeah, I have IBS, so my IBS prevents me from doing this and that, and my IBS, you know, is just, it's so bad as soon as this and that happens. Well, they're owning the disease. They're owning the condition. It is part of their identity, right? Okay, so values. Your values are created from your beliefs. And your values create your behavior. Your values make you decide what you're going to do. When I quit doing cocaine when I was in my early 20s, I know my values changed. Boom, that was it. I knew for sure that there was a line that I would never cross. Those are my values that I created in order to not do that. Okay, and Robin, repetition. So repetition is, you know, that we do something one time and golly, we have how many miles of neural pathways, Bob? So you change something one time. You go, oh, let's go learn to golf. So you get out there and you swing that golf club. Whoops, missed the ball. Swing it again. Missed the ball, hit it a couple times. That's it, you're done. Are you supposed to be a great golfer? Not yet. Because you have how many miles of neural pathways? 120,000 miles? Okay, so we have to use repetition to burn in those neural pathways to the places we want them to go on purpose. We don't want those neural pathways to keep growing in the direction of I missed the ball, I missed the ball, I missed the ball. We have to use very concentrated, focused repetition to the experience and the outcome we do want, right? Remember, these are all things that you want to be able to say to other people. These are the phrases and the words and the things you can do in your talks and your presentation and help people understand why each of these things is so important. So repetition, absolutely. We've got to train our brain by growing the neural pathways to change the chemical response that happens in our bodies that goes to our cells and all the receptor sites on the outside of the cells that are expecting a certain chemical and biological condition, and now it's something else entirely, but that goes in and affects the gene. Repetition. Okay, and Robin also said self-talk. So someone comes in to see you as a client and they want to quit smoking and you do your fantastic work and you've done everything you can so you know they got it made. And they walk out of your office and they say, this can't possibly work. I'm hopeless. I've been a smoker so long. I just know that, boy, I'm going to have a cigarette. I'm just going to. So no matter how brilliant your work is, if someone's self-talk does not support it, they're getting those old neural pathways that know exactly how to have a craving for a cigarette or continue to have their migraines or their back pain or whatever it is they have, go right back to the things that support that rather than the new experiences and outcomes, right? Right on! Say yes, brother! Yes, sister! Okay, so did we get six? We got desire, belief, values, identity, self-talk. Oh, self-sabotage. Six. Self-sabotage means that the negative behavior has a positive intention. If anybody doesn't know about self-sabotage work, which is called parts therapy, where you talk to a part that wants the bad thing and it's doing it for a positive intention. If you don't know that, go ahead and let me know. You're going to learn how to do self-sabotage work. Most of you know, but some don't. And we will need to work on that so that you understand how to do that. So you find the positive intention behind it. And then you get that part to, first of all, have its hidden agenda uncovered and it's known now. Then you get the part to find a different, healthier way to get what it needs. Big deal in creating wealth, worthiness, love, get rid of fears or phobias, addictions, things that you feel are out of your control when you keep sabotaging yourself. Jared says, uncover the secondary benefits. Yep. And substitute these. Also, fear of change, because the fear of losing the learnings they have of their past. Yes, absolutely. And Jared's a smart man. He knows his stuff really, really well. So he's someone you definitely want to keep learning from. So we have a Facebook group. If you haven't joined it yet or you haven't been put on the list, it may be because I couldn't find your Facebook name. The Facebook group, and it's a private one just for our trainees, is TAP Training. And if you would find, TAP stands for The Addiction Project. So TAP space training. Find that page. If you're not on it already, put a request to join, and I'll know that you're one of our students. And you're going to talk to people like Jared who are really, really smart and know their stuff inside and out. And you're going to accelerate the rate at which you learn this material. But even more exciting than that, oh my gosh, the people in the Facebook group and in our training, I am absolutely blown away at how energized, brilliant, genius, motivated, and supportive of each other that they are. There are people coming together in this training that are just bringing such amazing ideas and science and research and links to articles and things that are pushing us forward or propelling us forward faster than I ever imagined. So you're welcome, Jared. We are not at what we call the tipping point yet, but I anticipate that there's a point at which the Addiction Project is going to hit its tipping point, and I would anticipate it being in 2 or 3 months possibly, where we're going to be getting national attention, international attention, excuse me, to Ireland and Australia and the UK and France and all the places you guys are from. Woo! And we are going to have such exposure that we're going to be the place that people come to get, you know, something that makes so much sense. And it's not new. Like I say, I've been doing this for the addiction work for 10 years. I've been a hypnotherapist for 20 years. There's hypnotherapists out there that have been doing this work. But even better, there's people like Stanton Peel, who is an author that has hard science and research and the data to support the fact that AA and 12-step does not work, and there's methods that do work. There's people, if you follow Stanton Peel on Facebook, there's people that are in his kind of network that are brilliant people that are looking at the science and supporting the science aspect of how we overcome addiction. Bob says, another interesting book to read is The Brain That Changes Itself. Absolutely, and I think it's up there on my bookshelf. Yeah, another one, let me grab this. This is from Chris Prentice. It's the alcoholism and the alcoholism and addiction cure by Chris Prentice. The first half of the book is a story about his son who went to rehab about 10 times in 10 years, and Chris Prentice said, "This is ridiculous. This doesn't work. I'm taking him to all these different rehabs and it's not working." And he says they're getting it all wrong. So he opened his own place called Passages. And at Passages, they charge how much? $80,000 for 1 month. They have a team of hypnotherapists, 12 hypnotherapists. A few of them have been trained by me, and it's interesting hearing about what they do at that center. They have a very high success rate, about 85% long-term success rate. They do nutrition and acupuncture and massage and yoga. But I think the big deal is they change the beliefs about it not being a disease, about not relapsing, those sorts of things. So this is the latest issue of Scientific American, and it's not my address, but yes it is. Just in case anybody is watching who wants to come to my house. Oh wait, that's my post office box, never mind. So anyway, this is the Neuroscience of Habits. Very excited to read this because we have lots and lots of research that as a team that we are putting together that so supports what we're doing. Okay, so yeah, The Brain That Changes Itself. That's a great book, Bob. And if you were to contribute, not right now, but on our Facebook page, some of the pieces of that book that really give us some of the research, perhaps. I don't want you to go to like a lot of trouble to type stuff out, but maybe you could give us some of the gems that we can use to continue to back up the work that we're doing. Ellen, I am going to actually mention this right now because we're talking about types of treatment centers. So Ellen says, I was wondering how your program compares to rational recovery or smart recovery. So this is really important. Smart Recovery is a group that put together meetings that are not 12-step, and they're all over the world, but they don't have very many meetings. It's not very energized. It doesn't have much activity, and it's very hard to find a meeting, and it's not very regular. Smart Recovery, if you want to go and watch the video, I don't know if they still have the video on their website, but it was really cool because it's saying a lot of what I'm telling you right now. That, you know, we're getting it all wrong and we need to do it a different way. We have to have different beliefs about it. But I don't think smart recovery is thriving. It needs some energizing, and it might be an organization that we could partner with in some way. Rational Recovery has the AVRT, which is the ARVT? Okay. Somebody say what ARVT or AVRT? It's the voice. And they call it the beast, and it's kind of like a part of you. So they take this part and make it a separate part of you so that you can talk to it. And they call it the beast, and it's the thing that wants you to drink or do drugs. They're very successful. And I'm going to tell you a little bit about the business model of what they do. And I just talked to Lois. It's Jack and Lois Trimpe. They've been doing this forever. They have a book that just continues to sell on the shelf of every bookstore. They are very anti-AA and 12-step, very vocal about it. What they were doing was having people come to their place in California, and people got their own hotel room but would come for 4 days to their property to do training for 4 days to overcome your addiction. Very successful, wasn't cheap, it was about $3,000 a person, and they would have 30 or 40 people, and they'd be sold out for months in advance. Do the math! And people loved it, because there's so few alternatives to AA. So Rational Recovery is awesome. I like what Lois and Jack are doing, and if you call them, Lois or Jack will answer the phone, and they'll talk to you. Lois will talk your ear off, she's awesome. But she'll give you a lot of good information. So here's something about Rational Recovery that we also need to understand. They are not addiction treatment people. They're not an addiction treatment center. They're legally teaching people. This is education, not treatment. We are changing the way the world treats addiction, but we're not treating addiction. So what Jack and Lois have done, and I just had this discussion with her about a week ago, is, are you still legal? Have you had any little ripples of fear about being in the addiction business? Any hints of, you know, wrongdoing? She says, not at all. Not in over 20 years they've been doing this, nothing. Because they're education. You're teaching people how to quit their addiction or how to not relapse, or how to be, you know, bulletproof, which makes sense? Okay. All right, so those six elements of change, we talked about those, why those are critical. Your scope of practice, which is where I was going just now with this, is especially if you go to an addiction doctor and you're going to ask for referrals. Because here's another part of your work that's really, really needed. People who need to detox, they go to an addiction doctor and he or she charges about $1,000, gives them the medications they need to withdraw, alcohol or heroin or whatever drugs. They come back to the doctor every day and get checked, blood pressure, heart, that thing, that kind of thing. But there's nowhere else that they're being told to go other than to go to meetings. So the addiction doctors can send their clients, their patients to you as clients so that you can help them. Okay, so you're not treating addiction. You are a relapse prevention expert. You're not going to give medical advice because that is dangerous. People have gotten in trouble for that as hypnotherapists. However, you can hand them papers with information the same way you can write a book and hand it to somebody. And you can say, you know, there's a lot of people who are overcoming an addiction that use these supplements to repair their brain. So I know that this list is used by a lot of treatment centers, and there's a lot of really good, like, naturopath physicians or dietitians that will tell you that this is what you need to repair your brain and body. So here's a list. But I want you to know that I can't tell you to take these things because I'm not a doctor. Okay, so got that? Hey, Vanessa, good to see you. Vanessa is in Australia. It's very early. I'm glad you made it. So, all right. The journaling. In the notebook, the workbook rather, there is a lot of journaling. For instance, this section is about desire. What do you really want? Tells them about desire. It has them write about what they really want. And you're, of course, going to check and make sure that they write exactly what they want. But they're going to continue to journal. So on the next page, they'll have an assignment when they go home. And it asks them questions. And it has them write about it. And they have to write by hand, not type it into a computer. So why is journaling important? Who knows what journaling does to you? Your brain, your body, or anything like that. Go ahead and type it in. Yeah, so Vanessa is also new. Yay. We have many new people. So it's very exciting. And I'm excited that it's in many different countries because I'm going to come and see you. So when you write, when you're journaling, there's a kinesthetic part of it that certainly is the writing experience. But something happens in your brain and in your body when you're journaling, right? When you're writing about emotions and about the feelings you have about something, there's research that shows that it changes your immune system quite significantly. They took blood tests from two groups of people, had both of them write and journal, but one of them wrote about the details of an experience, the other wrote about the feelings of it. The group that wrote the details of it did not have a change in their levels of their blood of immune factors and such other things, I don't remember exactly. The group that wrote about the emotions and the feelings had a really significant change, not only in their immune system, but in other blood factors they could actually see happening, like within 1 hour, that fast. So Jared says, journaling helps you reframe. Bob says it secretes chemicals, absolutely. So what else does journaling do? And there's actually one element of it that I really want someone to tell me why journaling is so helpful. Gary says journaling helps to clarify one's thoughts and feelings. Absolutely. What else does it do? So, you know, it does create accountability as well. When you write things down, you have a much better chance of actually doing them. Joanne! Hi, Joanne! High five from the UK. Good to see you. Nice you could make it. Jared says it takes you out of associated negative state. Yeah. You know, and actually that might be more or less what I'm looking for. It takes the feelings that are swirling around inside of you, whether it's guilt or fear or anger or hopelessness or confusion, whatever it is, it takes them out and it puts them somewhere. And there's something about the position that those feelings are in. That's not the right word. The way you perceive them Now they're here. You can see them, understand them. You can cry about them, purge them, but they're here. They're not here. They're more concrete and specific. They are somewhere, you know? So like when people can't sleep at night, they say, oh, write down the problems you're having. Write down the things you're thinking about, because now they're not all over here. They're there. Edward says, repetition of the work that was done in the person's mind. Absolutely. Becky says it helps to integrate information, for sure. It integrates what you're learning, solidifies it, and you know what's great is your entire life is right here. Like, everything you're learning, and you get to this thing that's about changing your beliefs, and when you do the writing about it, all of a sudden you realize what those beliefs were and how you want to change them, and you see them very specific, and you see them on the page, and you're like, huh. You can go back and look at it. It's just everything about journaling is awesome. Everything is awesome. If you saw the Lego movie, sing along. Everything is great when you're part of the team. Okay, Gary said it engages the creativity and intuition associated with the right hemisphere of the brain. Very nice, Gary. Yeah. And the expression. So when your clients are journaling, you have to make sure they're writing about the emotional feelings, what they envision and experience, what they want to be, or what they're struggling with, but the emotional part of it. If you're doing this with a group, and maybe you have like 50 people in this awesome group that you're helping with addictions, have them check the journaling with the partner. So have each one look over their journaling. Does it talk about the real emotions? Does it have the nice raw fears and guilt and anger and things that they want to get out? And does it also have the things they're transforming? Minerva says it creates expectation of a life free from struggle. Okay, we're going to take a 10-minute break. Yay! So actually, let's take a 5-minute break. 10 minutes is too long. So it's my time, it's 6 minutes after, so at 11 minutes after we're going to start again, okay? So a little break, get up, move around, it's time for a dance party, I think. Yes, let's have a dance party. Here we are, I think I can have a dance party.
Oh, I love my sentence.
All right, at 11 minutes after, or whatever is 5 minutes from now.
I've had my share of We are the champions.
feel the air.
We are the champions. We are the champions. We are the champions.
Let's see. There we go. That's what I wanted to play. All right, I've got one more minute. Is called Swamp Fire. How fun is that? All right, so let's see where we are here. Yeah, Jared has another comment about the journaling that's very nice. It separates you, it separates the story of your life from who you are as a consciousness. Interesting. So this is something that's worth exploring about a person's story and who they really are or who they want to be, and understanding that you're not that story. Susie, hi again, Susie. Hi, five, Susie. Yes. Minerva says it creates expectation of a life free from struggle. Absolutely. The more you write, the more expectation there is that that's going to change. So we're going to get started if everybody is ready. Writing for me, journaling, has had some very profound effects on my life. One of the times that I started doing some journaling with some very specific outcomes was when I was beginning to be a hypnotherapist 20 years ago, and I was very broke. I was a single mom. My kids were very young. They were 3 and 6 years old, 3 years old and 6 years old. And we were really, really broke. It was bad. I called the welfare office one time because I needed heat in my house and I couldn't talk.
I cried so hard on the phone because I was so embarrassed that I couldn't even continue the call. I tried because we needed heat. Whew. But anyway, what I did is in my office, it was very small, but I would have these groups come into my office that wanted to work on wealth consciousness, being worthy of wealth. And we had a training I did called Financial Abundance. Now, I was poor at the time, but I still wanted to do this with my clients. So they would come in each week. So it was six people or eight people or so, and they paid $99 a month just to come to weekly meetings. But they had a workbook that I created, and they had to write down these specific outcomes. But the outcomes had to have emotions attached to them and the feelings that they wanted, and not the money. Well, the money was in there, but it wasn't the money we were focusing on. It was the things that were a result of creating success, being grateful for what you're creating, what it does and the ripple effect it has on others around you. So one of the points, and all of you can do this, maybe you have, but maybe you've thought about it, but one of the points was like, it was the beginning of November, and we were writing where we were going to be at in January and how our business was doing and our lives and everything else. So I had written down on mine that my income in January would be $20,000 or more. That was ridiculous because at the time I was making virtually no money, and I had my online business that was maybe making $1,000 a month. So in 2 months, supposedly I'm going to do $20,000. And we would visualize it and feel it and take ourselves into the future and implant it in the future and manifest it together. So every week when people came back, like our weekly stuff that we had written down would like happen. It would come true. It was amazing. Well, in that time, I had previously not had any media exposure at all. And I got flown to New York to go do the Queen Latifah show. It was a talk show she had at the time. And a Men's Health magazine did a 12-page article on my work. And there was a third thing that happened. But anyway, what was the third one? All three of those things took place, like came to fruition in January. The show aired in January. The magazine or the book thing came out in January and something else. So in January, how much did my business make online? Was like $20,050. It was almost exact. But I wrote it down, did say or more. I did not manifest the money part. Yes, the money is the reward, and I expect it. But what you manifest is what you want to feel and experience, why you want it, creating the desire for it, but also giving it out. And, you know, those of you who came to Boulder for our training, we did that manifesting thing, that ball of energy. And even though it's a little woo-woo, it's still an amazing, miraculous thing that you're creating and you're putting into motion. So I did that a few other times. My business was then, like, maybe a couple years later, was doing a couple hundred thousand in the year, and I wanted to do a million the next year, which was totally unreasonable. But I took this post-it note and wrote that I would do more than a million a year, and I'd open the door to my beautiful house in August, and I had no way to buy a house because I was still pretty poor. So I put that on the side of my computer monitor and left it there, and the next year, I don't know how everybody in the world got together and conspired about how much exactly they should order, but the sales that next year came to like 1,008,000. They were pretty close. The next year, I put in motion that I was going to do $2 million or more, and it was like $2,012,000. It's just weird. It's just so weird that everybody got together and did the math and figured it out. The reason I tell you that is because I want you to be able to do that as well. Write stuff down. Write down what you want, how you feel about it, what it will be like for you to accomplish these things, your sense of pride, the people you will help, the smiling faces of the families that are going to love your work, the lives you have saved, the people's lives you've repaired that possibly would not have gotten repaired any other way, people who would have been dead. So anyway, there's your little pep talk. All right. I love this next part. Now, some of you know the answer to this, others of you don't. So we're going to talk about desire. Does a person have to want to quit drinking or drugs? So this is a tough question, like with smoking. And you can go ahead and type in what your thoughts are about that. Do they have to want to quit? In quitting smoking, a client comes to you, and you very typically say, well, they've got to want to quit. They have to have a desire to quit. But is that true or not true? And that's what I'm asking you right now to tell me, although I already know, but I want to see what you think. So we think that someone has to want to quit, and when AA says they haven't hit bottom, I say, oh, yes, he's hit bottom, or, oh, yeah, I've hit bottom, you know, I'm sleeping in a gutter. Got my ass kicked by my meth dealer. I got shot at by my heroin dealer that I owed money to or something. Okay, none of those are about me. I just need those. Well, then you haven't hit your bottom. You don't really want it. When you want it, it'll happen. So do you have to know for sure that this person actually wants to quit drugs or drinking? And yeah, Susie is new, says yes, and we can help here, though. So she's answered it good, and we can help here. Bob says yes, they have to want to quit. So keep typing in there, everybody. I know there's a little lag in the questions and the chat. Susie says we can help create and certainly strengthen the desire. So what else? Becky says we can show them that they want to stop. Yeah. So I'll tell you the answer that I have to that question, because you're going to get this a lot from clients or treatment centers, addiction counselors. They're all going to say that a person has to want to quit. But someone doesn't have to want to. Their desire to continue doing drugs or continue drinking can be much greater than their desire to quit. There is a specific way that I'm going to talk about right now that you will give them an absolute certainty that they want to quit. You'll create the desire. Gary says, desire always precedes change. Absolutely correct, Gary. And he says, a good hypnotherapist can seed desire whether the addict wants to quit or not. Right on, Gary. Everybody give Gary a high five. Yes, you nailed it. Ellen says, I wonder if many people are really ambivalent about it. There are two parts. That's true. Joanne says, I work with young people forced by the court. Some make changes even if they didn't start out seeking help. And Vanessa says, sometimes the courts create a double bind for them. Kathy says, no, we can make them want to quit. Ding, 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 ding. Kathy. Yes, you're absolutely right. Okay. So you are going to help them have the desire to quit. If you had to make everybody wait until they were ready to quit, you'd never have a client ever in your life. People don't go to rehab and go to AA meetings and stuff because they really want to quit. They don't know what else to do. They don't like their crappy life and all the destruction in their life, but they didn't really want to quit drinking either. If someone has enough actual desire to quit, they'll quit on their own, and people do all the time. The success rate of people quitting cold turkey with no support and no help is pretty good. Stanton Peel has some statistics about that. So to help them want to quit, you can take that client and say, it's okay if you don't feel ready to quit. Just come and see me, and we're just going to do some exploring to see how high your desire is and see if you're ready. And there are some things that I might be able to help you with to help you decide that you really are ready. Okay, so one of the ways we do this is with a timeline of their future. And this is in your book, and it's on the recorded sessions and everything. But basically, the timeline of their future is, you know, you've got them in trance. They're imagining this future. It could be a path or a beam of light. It could be a beautiful rainbow that they move into their future. It could be a gravelly, dark, broken path. You don't want to suggest any one thing, but you can suggest several possibilities. But anyway, you start going along that path of your future, and I want you just to take a few steps, and as you imagine taking those few steps into the future, you notice that you're going a few days into the future, and just keep moving along on that path of your future. And now you'll get to a point where the path splits. It has a fork in the road off to the left and to the right. So just stop when you get right there. And now I just want you to notice that you do have two choices that you can make. And that path to the left is to continue on the life and the path and the style of living that you're used to. And the path on the right is to make a big, huge change and live a different life that you might feel good about. So I want you to take a step on that path to the left and just move into the future of that path to the left. You know it really well. It's the life you've been living. You understand it. There's some pain. There's some fun. There's some sadness. But as you move on to that path on the left and you go farther into the future, you're getting older and you're doing the same thing you've been doing. So as you move a little farther, maybe a year or two or five into that future, I want you just to take a moment to notice all around you in this future moment what's happening in your life. How do you feel? A few years ago, you wanted to change your life and you wanted to quit doing drugs. You really wanted to, but it was easier to just do this. But now just notice what's happening. Okay, now as a side note for the therapist part of it, so you don't want to do too much leading. They have enough pain and misery in this future moment. You don't want to implant or suggest more pain or suffering or guilt or agony. They're already in it, trust me. Okay, so back to the process. So now at this moment in the future, I want you to notice those two little boys of yours. They've grown up a little bit. They're a few years older. And just look in their eyes and just notice what's there. I know you've tried, but how does it feel right now? What's it like? I want you to go farther into the future now. Just continue on that path. Few more years. What's happening to your body? What's happening to your brain? What are you doing with your life? Again, therapist side note, you don't need to implant any bad feelings in this one, trust me. Okay, so at some point, if you're working with the client privately, you're going to see there's going to be tears and there's going to be some pain and say, right now what I want you to do on the count of three is float up above that point in the timeline. I want you to just float up and let all those feelings go. Ready? One, two, three. Float up. Light, light, light. Good. Just float up above it. And just take whatever it is you've learned and experienced. Float all the way back, right back here to this present moment on your timeline where that path split. So come right back down to that fork in your path. Good. Let your feet touch down. Now I want you to notice that the path to the right is something that is a totally different life and that will require a decision to be made by you. A decision that's made deep in your heart and your soul. But right now I just want you to experience it and find out what it might be like if you do decide to quit doing the drugs or the drinking. So now take a step out onto that path to the right. And as you take those steps, notice that you're going into the future. You're going a few months or a year, a couple of years into the future. Just keep going. Okay, now as a therapist, side note, this is where you do want to do some leading. You want to implant some of the things to create expectations and happiness and joy and such. So, okay, so back to the path. So right now, just notice, there you are at about 2 years in the future, perhaps. And I want you to notice what you're experiencing and what you're feeling. You did something a couple years ago that really did change your life in every possible way. I want you to notice right now in this future moment, how good does it feel? What do you feel most proud of yourself for? What is your biggest accomplishment? 2 years ago, you made the decision to quit drinking. It felt good. From that moment, you never thought about it again. And here you are at this moment in the future. What did you accomplish that makes you feel the best about yourself? Good. Now I want you to move a little bit farther in the future. Just keep going another year or so. And I want you to notice those two little boys. They grew up a little bit. They're a little older and a little bigger. Yeah. I want you to look in their eyes. When they're there looking in your eyes, what do they see now? What are they proud of? How does it feel to have such a clear, honest relationship with them that you can look in their eyes, play, laugh, be the best dad, and they know they can trust you? How does that feel? What is that like? Good. Now I want you to notice around you other people who are important to you. You've chosen to have in your life the people who really do matter to you. And so on and so on. Okay, so as a side note is, notice the difference in my tone of voice. Definitely implanting expectation, asking questions that presuppose that they do feel that way at this moment in the future. Right? So, you know, now that you remember how easy it was the day you decided to quit drinking, and you feel so healthy, what is the best thing about it? So a presupposition, a future pacing. So now you're going to have them float up above that moment in the future, come all the way back, float all the way back to the present moment, let your feet touch down in that present moment. And I want you to know that every step that you take in your life is a decision, just like this one, to take a step to the left, to the path that is a life that you know, and as painful as it has been, it's still something that you know very well, or the one that is new and different, and the path to the right that holds the pride and the joy and the experiences that you really do want to have, that you do deserve to have. And in a moment, I'm going to ask you to take a step. And that step you take is not to be taken lightly. It is a decision that you're going to make that is going to affect your mind, your body, your soul, your heart, your thoughts. And I just want you to know how much you really do want this. Okay, so now, what I am doing is just making it absolutely irresistible and that there's just no chance they could step on that path to the left. However, someone might sometime. Someone may just step on that path to the left. So this is about creating desire. So now you build this up and you don't let them take that step too quickly. You want lots of time to process this and lots of language that's going to put them in that state of mind that, you know, it might say something like, it may seem that the next step that you take is an easy decision, but before you do, just notice what effect it's going to have on you, the people you love, the experiences that you so deserve to have. So make sure it's real and only take that step if it's 100% and if you feel the integrity that says, yeah, I got this. So I'm going to go ahead and count to three, and on the count of three, take that next step that is the next step in your life, the direction that you really want to go. One, two, really feel it now. Know that this is what you want. And three, take that step. And if they're in your office or you're doing this with a group, now you want to have some music queued up ready to go that's bright and exciting and just has like sparkles and happiness music that rises and rises and rises. Because music really anchors an experience. It anchors the emotions. And we want to get that anchored as big as possible. This experience that you're giving your client is the start of them building those three beliefs that are healthy, strong, and in control. Okay? So any questions about that, any thoughts about that? You just created desire. So our question was, do they have to want to quit? And now, after you do this process with them, they want to quit. I mean, they have just looked at the fact that I can give up 2 more years of my life, 3 more years of my life, and trash it even more, but I could do this. And their brain, their subconscious is already believing that it was easy, and that the minute they made the decision, everything got better and better and better. Do they want that? Yeah, they do, more than anything. So most people I've worked with, I mean, they say, oh, man, you waited so long. I just wanted to just get on that path to the right so bad. You just, like, you're making me wait. Yeah, exactly. We want them to get so much anticipation that it's churning their body and their brain up. So the minute they take that step to the right, boom. Okay. So now when they do that, you do continue to take them on that path to the right, and you let that one to the left dissolve as you're, oh, there you are, doing the things that you really do love to do, and you notice that other path, it's just dissolved. It's fallen away. It's whatever. Make sense? Okay. That's how you create desire. So, all right. So the other thing I have in my notes is give the client the lecture. And I'm hoping all of you printed out your notes so you can refer to these. Because someday maybe you can do this training for new people in your country where you live. So the lecture, and actually somebody, and it might be actually Becky, I think, is in here. Becky, was it you that asked me about this? Because we were talking about your quiz, your exam, and you said, what about the lecture thing? And I said, oh, no, that's only for smoking. But it's on my notes here, and it's not. So the lecture is this, and I do apologize for being inconsistent on that answer. You know, I know you've told me, Jim, that you're not really sure that you can quit, or you're not really sure that you want to, because you really, really like drinking, and I totally get it. Most people feel that way until they realize how easy it is to be a non-drinker and how freeing it is to be a non-drinker. But, you know, there's another part of it that maybe you haven't really thought about. And at some point in the future, when you go to the doctor and they tell you the results of your liver test, and they say, you know, it looks like 6 months because your liver just cannot take it anymore. And, you know, the same thing happens with drugs, too. Their liver goes with most drugs, or it kills you in other ways. But anyway, we'll talk about drinking for now. So, you know, I understand that you still want to keep drinking and that that's a fun part of your life. But what if you discover that your life really is more fun? But here's the part that's going to be tough, is when you come home from the doctor 2 years, 5 years, 7 years from now, and you have to look in the eyes of your wife and your kids, and you have to tell them that you are going to die. You're going to see the horror and the worst pain and the worst fear in your children's eyes and your wife's eyes that you could ever imagine. You will wish that you could come back to this moment right here, right now, and change it. But at that point, you can't go back. But you would say, I'll do anything if I can just go back in time to that moment where you're sitting right here in this office and make it happen for real, 100%. But it's not going to be just that moment that's going to get you. The next part is that you have to watch your family watch you die. You have to watch them just lose it over you dying because of a decision you made to keep drinking. And I guarantee you, you'll wish that you could come back right here to this moment right now and just make it work. And I can help you make it work. I never want you to go through that. I don't want you to be in that position ever. I don't want you to have even a thought about that. But that is the reality. You know how many people alcohol kills? I think 10. Like, I don't know if you guys read this, but was in a news release recently, it was 10% of all deaths or 20% of all deaths are from alcohol. Ooh. Anyway, so that's the deal. That's the lecture. You may want to replay this and take some notes. Bob says, do you have a song that you like for this? I do, in fact. I don't think it's on my iTunes. Let me look for just a second and see if I can find it. Nope. So, probably an instrumental, and it doesn't have to be hypnotic. It needs to be something that moves you. This one would be a possibility. I used to use this quite a bit in some of my work. This is not my favorite one. But this one kind of grows, if you can hear it. Then it starts getting better. So music that you create for that, it just music that keeps opening up and opening up. This is the O of Pleasure. Ray Lynch's Deep Breakfast album, it's the O of Pleasure. The other one, God, I gotta remember the name of it. It'll come to me. I'll let you know. Here it goes. This is really beautiful right now. Aww. This brings back such memories because I have used this music in my office with my clients. I haven't seen clients for 10 years. Aww. And it's got serious undertones, and it's got movement. Here it comes. Anyway, it will keep going. So if you can find that, download that. It'd be really nice to use with a group as well, because it will help move them to the emotion that you want them to have. Jared says, great emotive, inspiring lecture. Yeah, Becky, thanks for bringing that to my attention in our phone call. All right, so there you go. That's, do they want to have to quit? What's your new answer? No, they do not have to want to quit. Some of you already understood what I was driving at, that you have the tools to help them absolutely make them want to quit. I don't know if you knew that you had such powerful tools as the one I just described or the lecture that I just had. You might have had some ideas on it, but hopefully this one is like, ah, I'm going to nail it. Thank you, Gary, for typing that in. Deep Breakfast by Ray Lynch. And that is the O of Pleasure. Leading the client. So I mentioned this when we were doing the split timeline. Leading the client. Typically, those of you who are hypnotherapists have been told, don't lead, right? You're doing regression to cause or whatever other things, and you don't want to lead your client. However, there is a time when it is okay. When you're on the timeline of the past, you don't need to lead them. Trust me, they already feel bad enough, as I've said many times. You just ask them what they're experiencing. Say, how does it feel? What is it that you're noticing when you look in the eyes of your kids? What is happening with this and that? But leading the client in the future timeline, absolutely. It is your job to give them something that is so powerful and so overwhelmingly awesome because they get to be the person they were meant to be. They get to have accomplishments and pride, and they get to find out who they are without being all effed up by alcohol or drugs. Lead, lead, lead in that future moment. Okay? All right. So now we want to talk about brain science a bit. And any questions in the meantime? Any questions? Go ahead and type them in if you want, and then we're going to get ready to spend, we've got about 17 minutes left, and we're going to talk about brain science. So brain science, of course, is something you've got to be really good at. You've got to be able to talk about this stuff so that we know that you actually can back up what we're saying, that the addiction project's work is science-based. And you've got to be able to talk the talk, right? Especially if you're going to be talking to any doctors, doing a presentation to the staff at a treatment center, talking to clients. You're going to have dentists and doctors come in who are addicts and they've got to quit. You have professional people who are going to pay you a lot of money to come to your four-day intensive, and you've got to be able to say the right things to back up your science-based claims. Becky says, how powerful for them that they know they don't have to want to quit. Ooh, yeah. Yeah, that's very true what Becky just said. Because they're like, but I like drinking, and I don't know how I would even manage. I won't be able to be around anyone who drinks. I'm not going to be able to go out to any social events. On Friday on Boulder, oh, every day in Boulder at the businesses here, because it's this huge like tech startup capital of the country, like Silicon Valley kind of. But you got beer kegs, cocktail carts that are wheeled around the office. They make cocktails for them in the afternoon. They have happy hours in the office. So you're thinking, oh, yeah, I'd kind of like to quit because I've destroyed my life, but how am I ever going to do that? I won't be able to go anywhere or do anything ever again. Okay. And they will. So I was walking through the grocery store one day, and this woman came up to me and said, Wendy, you're Wendy. Oh, my gosh, I can't believe I'm meeting you. My husband listened to your CDs for the quit drinking. And she says, we've tried everything, but he listened to your CDs, and not only did he quit drinking, it's been 6 months now, but he's so happy, like, socializing, we can go wine tasting, and he drinks Pellegrino, because that's one of the things I put in as a to create a desire for them to drink, like, Pellegrino and bubbly water. She says, when we have company over to the house, he makes the drinks, and that makes him feel even better that he doesn't want any. Wow, cool. Anyways, that was cool. Brain science. So we know that we don't want to lead, but we also don't want to create false memories. However, we have to in this case. So the way that we get the brain to grow these neural pathways to the things we do want is by creating false memories of a future experience. And this future experience has to have three elements, which we're going to talk about, being strong, being healthy, being in control. So people go to an AA meeting, and they are experiencing possible future scenarios. All of them are pretty dark and scary, full of struggle, possible relapse. There aren't any that are helping them envision their body being healthy, their mind and soul being strong, and their spirit being in control of what's happening. They are all filled with the opposite of that. So we want to create this bank of false memories. Then we want to connect these neural pathways to it. So if you can explain this, you can help someone understand why people are failing. So maybe you're talking to some staff at a treatment center and saying, you know, I know you've talked to me about how low your success rate is and how frustrated you are that you can't get your clients to take home with them what they learned while they were in your center. But here's why. The brain science, it shows us that we grow these neural pathways that connect with similar emotional experiences. And so now they go home and they see something that triggers their desire to do meth. Or they've been driving by the street corner where they used to buy from their dealer, and their brain automatically, those pathways go to the desire, the emotion, the connection, the high. All of that is energized instantly. It happens so fast on a subconscious level because these neural pathways only know how to go to desire for the drug or the high or the alcohol. They haven't created anything new for their brain to seek out. So here's what we do with the Addiction Project is we actually have people being in their future imagining their body being healthy, all the beliefs that go with that, the pride that goes with that, the things they do to feed their body the right foods, to get exercise, to love their physical life. In fact, one of our clients in the Addiction Project, he had failed and failed and failed for decades in and out of rehab, and finally, at 45 years old, he decided to use the CDs that we have in the Addiction Project, and he envisioned himself in the future being an Ironman triathlete, even though he doesn't work out. He'd never run a step in his life. And he began training to be an Ironman triathlete. So when his brain was triggered to activate the need for alcohol, it went to this future memory that we built that was him loving his accomplishments as an Ironman triathlete. So he started training immediately, and now it's been over 10 years, and this man travels the world doing Ironman triathlons. And you guys can tell that story. That is one of my clients. He's amazing. But we built that future memories. Okay, so now you're back to talking to the treatment center. So what we want to do for your clients is build this future memory, which the brain does not know the difference between a real and an imagined event. So the brain holds this memory as real can be. But now we're going to get these neural pathways to send the signals to that feeling. They're going to feel physically healthy, and they're going to feel strong, and strong is their character, their beliefs, their truths. They're going to build integrity that is really strong, probably something they've never had. They're going to envision it and experience it in this future of what that does for them. And then we're going to build into that that they are in control, that they truly can make the choices they want to make. They can make the good decisions, that they make them instantly because they're in control. So we're going to build all of this into this future memory, get the brain's neural pathways to seek that out. But even better than that, we're going to make sure that the trigger, the need for the drug or the alcohol, even the triggers that are so subconscious that your client doesn't even know are happening, and we're going to get those that before they're even aware, before they can apply willpower, we're going to get those triggers to instantly go to the desire to be strong, healthy, and in control, experiencing it as if it's already happened. And then what happens to them is absolutely miraculous. No cravings, no desire for the drugs or the alcohol, but they do replace that with a desire to be a happier parent, to go do their yoga that they're committed to work out, to take up their career as a painter that they had loved. Make sense? Okay, so that would be, I mean, that's an explanation for you, but also for someone you're talking to, right? Yeah, thank you, Vanessa. New transderivinal search, brilliant. Yep. All right, so there is the brain science creating new false memories, the neural pathways that go to that. Now it gets really exciting. Remember we talked about identity, and identity being one of the things that they have got to shift? So now, when you go see your future self, and this is a separate process, but you could also explain this to, like, the staff of a treatment center or whoever. When you go into this imaginary future, we're going to have you meet your future self. When you look at your future self, there's something really amazing that happens. We've discovered in the last decade or so these mirror neurons. Mirror neurons are the things that we have in our brain that make us want to do something or learn something by assimilating what we see. A baby has such an overwhelming desire to walk. Why? Because it sees everyone walking, and the mirror neurons absorb all of that without language or words, and we're doing this all our lives, not just as a baby. And it's absorbing all of that of people walking, and it's trying to assimilate this ability, this physical ability, but also the drive and the desire to do that. Okay, so that's the mirror neurons. So you meet your future self, and for your client, when you take them into that future moment to meet their future self, you describe what's happening with that future self, and it's a process that I'll go over with you, not today. But the thing that really is cool is that your mirror neurons, or your client's mirror neurons, when they're seeing that future self, they're doing that same thing and absorbing it. Then you say on the count of three, and this is after you've done the process with the future self, but on the count of three, you're going to jump into that body of your future self. You're going to see through those eyes, feel with that heart, and you're going to be in there knowing what it's like to be totally free from all that crap in your past, being strong and healthy and in control. Ready? On the count of three, jump inside that body. One, two, three. In that body, look through those eyes and feel with that body and that mind and that soul. And here's where you're going to be leading again. Say, from inside of your future self, notice what it's really like to have integrity, to never have to make anything up or lie about anything or hide about anything. What is it like to be that free and that honest and that proud of yourself? Good. So I want you to let your mind and your body absorb all of that, of who you are in this future moment, why it's important to you, and what it really means. Okay, blah, blah, blah. Then I want you to get back out of that future body, that future self on the count of three, da, da, da. Come out of that future self. Look in the eyes of that future self now, standing there face to face. Just look in those eyes. And at this point, there's a little more to the process. You have the future self telling the other self, like, really cool things about what it's like to be, woo, living that life. But what's really cool is this brain science of the mirror neurons has been working like crazy. Like, how do I assimilate that? How do I make that work? Adapting. Does that make sense? So remember, write that down. I mean, it's on here, but write the notes that are how the mirror neurons work. Do a little bit of homework. Share some ideas in our Facebook group about what the mirror neurons do and how they affect us. Yes! Okay, so now we have 5 minutes left. Next part of your homework is 18 to 21, pages 18 to 21 in the printed manual. Because the printed manual and the online one have different page numbers. Okay. Page 18 in here starts with detox from alcohol or drugs. And then the next page says it should be easy to make a decision to quit drinking. And there's some stuff about problem drinkers and medical advice. So just get into that part of it, which is, let me just go back. There's detox from drugs or alcohol. It should be easy. Problem drinkers, moderation, and medical advice. Okay, so read those four as well, and do discuss them in the Facebook group, because we have many new people and many that have already taken the training online and did it in person, and they're there to help, and we want to learn from all of you as well. Okay, other questions? We're going to wrap it up in about 3 minutes. So I know that our classes this time are very close together. There's not a lot of time to do the homework in between, because we have a class today and tomorrow. We get Sunday off, and then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, 3 days in a row, thanks to my silly trigger finger that deleted the videos accidentally. I know, hard to imagine. I think I'm pretty smart, but not all the time, apparently. Okay, so questions or thoughts? We're just going to, I'll take about another 5 minutes and we'll go over any questions that you have. What other questions? One of the things that I did not discuss on this, I think, that's on here, was the business models. Oh, here's the other homework, was read the business plans up to page 16. So we're going to discuss the different business plans tomorrow. And what those are is they're business models of ways that you can see clients and all the possible ways that you can see groups, private clients, go to the treatment centers, work with addiction doctors, create a big event that would be an addiction event, have free classes. Like, I think you could have free classes every Tuesday night consistently for an hour and a half, and I have a whole outline of what to do for that exact amount of time. And everything's written out for you of step by step. And this is from years and years and years of finding out what works. So look at the business plans and let's talk about those. And the other part of the business plan is to create a center where people come, like the one I told you about in California, the guy that was the director that told the other guy, you're a high relapser. Well, he had a room that had four white walls and metal folding chairs, and Monday through Friday, you could come in and have a meeting, AA meeting with him, and that's it. And it was $12,000 a year, and he had about 100 members that would pay for a year. You couldn't come, you couldn't pay for less. You pay for a full year. And on the good side is, it's good to have a year of support, because people have already failed and failed and failed. They want you to be there, and they want to have something solid for a year. But do the math. But you could do that and do this awesome work. Vanessa says, I need to find the manual, as mine have not arrived. Vanessa, there's a link on the notes page. It is in the Addiction Project, and it was a link I also sent you in the email, and I'm going to give it to you. And it has the download for the manual. Okay. So, glad you asked. Okay, this is the page that has the download link for the manual. Okay, and there are a lot of links on there that you might need. Joanne, same thing, I don't have a link to the manual. So that page, I just put the link in there. Your password is TAP99. And of course, this page is only for you if you're a paid student, okay? Respect the work. If you have friends and colleagues that want to get in on this training, send them to the page to sign up, but don't give out passwords and links. Okay, so there's, can we download the training videos? Like the one from the previous five classes of training? Or these, the new ones we're doing? I think you can download them. I think, Susie, I think you need a little piece of software that downloads YouTube videos. So these will not be public on YouTube, but you will be able to view them through the direct link that you have already. And the same link that you use to come into this class, that link will take you to the replay. Now, I suspect that it's going to take probably half an hour for the video to render and be loaded onto wherever, but the same link that you use to get into the class is the same link to look at the replays. Make sense? So downloading them? I think so. Yes. What other questions? Are you coming to London this year? Cheerio, Bob. Absolutely. I'm shooting actually for September. I just need to pick a date. I found a couple of really cool vacation houses, and this is how I want to do the training, Bob. So we did in Boulder. We found a vacation house that had a lot of beds, and we did the training in that house. The food was stocked by me into the refrigerator. Everybody shared the cost of the house. And so we did the training there, which eliminates so much of the cost of, you know, hotels and conference rooms and other hotel rooms. So you get to stay really cheap and be there together. We had fun, and we had a field trip, which we're all sworn to secrecy about, but it was very fun. People got to do some really interesting things. So, Bob, I'm shooting for September. If you know of a big vacation house that would sleep 12 to 15 people minimum, I'll look into that, okay? I just need to secure something. So I have a lot of people that want to do the training in London. So, yes! Okay, any other questions? I'll stay on board for a few more minutes just for some more questions. So, yeah, those of you who are new, thank you for being here. I'm so grateful. I am convinced that as a team, we're going to take this thing all over the world. That is my big goal, is to change the way the world treats addiction. It's funny, when I started doing this work like 8 or 10 years ago, I started toying with the idea of like, I think I want to like change the way people treat addiction. And my statement was, I'm going to change the way the United States treats addiction. I thought, oh, that's a really big goal. That's really hard. Yeah. Then I finally got it. I said, no, I'm going to change the way the world treats addiction. I'm in a position to do it, and I have the experience and the results and the proof, and there's a whole bunch of experts that are not me that also back up this kind of work. And right now it's growing and accelerating so fast with the experts, you know, giving the science-based methodology the credit that it needs. Yeah, Edward says a field trip was interesting. Yeah, what was more interesting is what happened a few hours later. So anyway. Susie says, is there any way I can help you? Absolutely. So one of the things that I've told all of our trainees is I cannot do this alone. For me to commit to this was really difficult because I know I can't do it alone. I need a lot of help and a lot of support from all of you. My other goal is to help you all make a lot of money. I want you to save lives and make a huge dent in the whole addiction process of treatment. I want you to feel really grateful for what you're doing and make a lot of money. But also, I really, really need all of you to assist me in this. Yep. So, yeah, Susie, we could talk. Get in the Facebook group so we can talk there a little bit. And there are many ways you can help me. Here's something else while I'm waiting for you to type in questions that I kind of like. I've been wanting something that is, you know, like AA gives you these chips, and it's your, like, one-month chip and your two-month chip and your one-year chip. And, you know, people feel really proud of that, and they should. So I have been looking at things that have meaning and that we would anchor our strong and healthy and in control and all the values and all the things that we love about this into something. So this here is, I have like 100 of these that I bought from a nice shop in China. But anyway, this is a tree of life, right? And this is an infinity symbol. And it's a little leather bracelet that can be worn by a man or a woman. My idea is that when you wear this and you see it, you know, for it to be a bracelet, you'll definitely see it, then it triggers consciously and subconsciously what you believe about yourself, about the strength, and it just keeps reminding you of what you want and what's true for you, right? So these would be something that you would be able to give your clients. And I also ordered another one. I think I have 200 of these. Just a little different style. And it's also got the Tree of Life on it. And then there's something I want to do with this red. It's leather, actually, but this red sort of leather bead. So this is also the Tree of Life. And I have something I've written up that's about how you would embed all these aspects of your new being and your growth and your foundation and the strength and everything that is about the Tree of Life. Thank you, Minerva. And then also there's something I've done that's about the color red that I got from Don Motton, and it's about when you see the color red, 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 beautiful, bright, vivid red on a lady's fingernail or a button on a shirt or the stoplight when you're in your car, that red will make you blank, 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 right? So it's an anchor. So we might connect that with that red thing. So this is another one that's just a really nice bracelet that works for male or female. Susie says, a really lovely and positive symbol or metaphor and trigger. Yeah, the stuff I started writing about what we could embed with all the things that the Tree of Life would mean is pretty cool. So that's what I want our clients to have, something that they absolutely attribute to you. And if someone was to say, oh, wow, isn't that an interesting bracelet you've got there? It's a Tree of Life. Say, yeah, I got that when I decided that I was the shit. When I decided that I had it going on and my life was where I wanted it to be. Something like that. Yep, it's a great anchor for sure. So I am open to more anchors. Now someone, I think it was Minerva, you said like about the coffee mug, which is a great idea. Wouldn't that be nice? So every time you go to drink your tea or your coffee, you're like, wow, huh? And we anchor that image and whatever the word is on it. And it doesn't have to say anything about AA or 12 steps or relapse as part of recovery or one day at a time or serenity now. It says something that we anchor in that has a really powerful meaning. So, yeah, Minerva, I think that the coffee mug would be a great idea. Bob, a question from watching your three free classes last week. Do you prefer to do the swish technique with a client in hypnosis, or doesn't it matter? I like doing it in trance, for sure. I want them to experience it from in that really nice deep trance state. And I do my swish thing a little bit different, because when they're done and we're settling on the new outcome picture, the one they want, I have them wanting to jump into it, but they don't jump into it yet, you know. And then the beautiful music starts, of course. But notice the colors are so bright and so vivid and so beautiful, and you want to feel what it's like to be inside of that and let it surround you, and you want to just know, and in a moment you're going to jump into it, and it's going to be bigger than life and beautiful, bright. So I have them jump into it, and maybe other people do this, but I know the way it was originally taught was just to watch it disassociated. But you do the whole swish process disassociated, but the one you jump into is that outcome picture. So, yes, in hypnosis, Bob, yeah. Susie says, great to have lots of anchors. Yeah, wouldn't it be nice? So people come in and they get to, every time they come in to see you, they get to take something home. It's a bracelet, then it's a coffee mug, then it's like, I don't know, a piece of a rainbow, a unicorn, I don't know, what do they get? Well, it's 10 minutes after, so I need to let you guys go. I'll see you tomorrow. Get into that Facebook group, Tap Training. Get in there. And reply to my emails with the Facebook name if you want me to invite you in there, if you can't find it. And any other needs you have. Okie doke. All right. Are we ready? Let me find some music to go out on here. Hold on. Maybe we'll continue deep breakfast. Yes, we will. Okay, I'm Wendy Friesen. It's been awesome! Class 1B! See you tomorrow! 1B, or to be, or not to be, to be. Oh. Susie, you're very welcome. Nerva, you're welcome. Paul, you're very welcome. I'm glad you are all here. Tell your friends, send them to the Addiction Project. There's a link there that they can sign up to be part of the training. But it's not too late. Let's see if I can. Crap, that's not what I'm going to do. Let me grab that link. You wanted to send your friends to sign up. The more people we get, the better we're going to be, the stronger we're going to be. Also, to build up a bigger group that wants to do the in-person training as well. So here comes the link. So you send them there to that link. I hope you see that. It says Certified Trainer. It's on the Addiction Project page, Certified Trainer, and that'll give them a link to sign up. So they can still sign up. You're welcome, Joanne. They can still sign up and catch up on the recorded sessions. There's several people who have chosen to take the course by just watching the recordings until I deleted them. Surprise! Okay. You're welcome, Edward. All right. I think I will do it. Oh, no. Deep breakfast is not done. Still got a minute and a half. I think it's going to like build again. Yeah. Here it comes again for a minute and a half. Remember to print out your notes for tomorrow's class too. Do your homework. That'd be awesome. Remember that. There we go.
Okay, I think Ray Lynch has nailed it. You guys have a fantastic day. Signing off. I can find the window to sign off in. Where'd he go?
There. Bye-bye.